times is just God's plan for your life. One thing I want to share with you tonight is Jeremiah 29:11. This is one of my absolutely favorite verses. This is out of the Amplified Bible. For I know the thoughts, it's Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the thoughts and plans that I have for you, says the Lord. Thoughts and plans for welfare and peace, not for evil, to give you a hope in your final outcome. Isn't that awesome? To give you hope. Now, I just think if you can have hope, you can get through anything. Hope is so important. And one of the verses I want to share, this is a New English translation in the same verse, Jeremiah 29:11. For I know what I have planned for you, says the Lord. I have plans to prosper you, not to harm you. I have plans to give you a future filled with hope. Uh-huh. Yes. Now think about that, filled with hope. You know, God always does things big. You know, I mean, when he says to give you abundance, he gives you a lot. You know, he always gives you more than you ask for. You know, the one thing I love about God is that he knows where you're at, and he's always planning your life. Now think about that. You know, sometimes we think, oh, I don't know if I can make it. Well, God says you can make it. You know, because Jesus Christ says, I am the way. Which way should I go? Jesus Christ said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. So there's always a way. You know, and if you always believe and have hope, you know, somebody says, you know, they sometimes talk about, you know, I come to the bottom of the barrel, the end of my rope, you know. And I said, well, that's good. You know, it's why you say stuff like that's good. You come to the end. Jesus is at the end because he says I'm the beginning and the ending. You know, he's always there. Sometimes we fall down and get to the bottom, so the only place we can look is up. You know, the one thing I love about the Lord is that you're always on his mind. There used to be a song, I believe it came out in the 80s. You know, when Jesus was on the cross, I was on his mind. I love that song. You know, you don't hear it much. I don't hear it much more. But you know how important it is to think that when he was on the cross, who was he thinking about? You know, when Jesus was talking to disciples about praying, you know, he's going to pray. He's going to pray for those that would believe the disciples through the word. He's going to pray. He was praying for us way down the line. You know, what I always love about the grandmas and the moms and the mothers of the church, the one thing I always loved about them, they was always praying. Yeah. You know, we in churches sometimes, you know, we'd have the altar in the front, you know, and people would pray for you, and they'd come down the altar. One thing I love at my mom's church before she passed away, they had, it looked similar to our offering basket, but they had prayer requests in there. And one day what happened is the prayer request, mom was supposed to put it in the basket, but it missed the basket and got on the floor. And so I didn't realize what it was at first, and I got it. And she was praying for her kids. I opened it up. She was praying for her kids. Lord, help my sons. You know, I thought, wow, that is so powerful. You're still praying, still believing. So that's why you never give up on people. You know one thing about it, folks? God is good. You know, he's holy, he's righteous, he loves you, and he's always thinking about you. You know, that's what was told me about, you know, Father's Day's coming up, and you know, they ask you about being a father. You know, you never stop thinking about your kids. You never. When they get older, there's other issues they have, you know. Yeah. You know, it's not turtles and snakes when they're, you know, as they get a little older. You know, if you work, can we keep this turtle and bring it home? So, well, you know, that's fine when you're 5 or 6, but, you know, we're 35. I think we can probably move on a little bit past that, you know. But it's the thing. Those things matter. And, you know, the times you remember the most is those times you commune with God. Isn't they precious when you cry out to him? I think bedtime prayers are so precious because sometimes the kids will really bear their heart. I want you to pray for this person and that person. You know, and I tell you, a lot of times when you have the grandkids, you know what they'll say to touch their heart? Hey, Grandpa, I want you to pray for Mom, too. I want you to pray for Mommy. You know, she's trying so hard. You know, you have single moms that's trying so hard, but she's so tired. Grandpa, let's pray for Mom. And you know what you do? You pray. And you just see their heart just cry out. And I just want to thank the Lord tonight for how good he is, and he has a plan for my life and your life, and that's why we should never give up on people. That I don't know, that's been in my heart for a long time. We had our two students test today. It's been in last class, and I was just so thankful. I was able to start with them in the classroom, and we only had four. It was a small class. Every one of them passed today.
Yes.
You know, they have 100%. I thank God. It was an effort by everybody. It's not just one person, but an effort by everybody. You know, and I was talking to a friend today. You know, I said, I want everybody to succeed.
Yeah.
I want everybody to get on the right path. You know, that's the thing about it. You know, there's no way we're going to make a destination if we don't stay on the train and stay on the rail. We're not going to make it there if we don't. So that's what God wants us to do. And tonight, I want y'all to celebrate what God has done for you. So we're going to open this time up to praise God. Praise God what he's done for you. His plans. He's going to give you hope. He's going to give you a future. He'll never give up on you. That's what I love about God. You know, he's not giving up on you, because sometimes, you know, you might feel like it. I know old Moses had to feel like that 40 years in the wilderness. Oh, man, that first few years, that was bad. But the first decade, man, am I here? I'm clear out here. Second decade, 20 years. Well, what are you doing, God? I mean, I don't see nothing. 30 years? Oh, man. Man, where'd God go? Went on a long vacation. I came here. But 40th year. Moses turned aside, didn't he? And his life changed forever. He said, I turned aside. You know, I'm going to turn away from my old life with Moses. I'm going to come towards you. And look what God did in the next 40 years of Moses' life, to lead all those people out, to lead them to the Lord. That's what he was doing. But God took all the stuff that wasn't him. Moses was trying to lead him his way. God said, no way. You got to do it my way. And my way is to trust me. Trust my leadership, because I'm never going to leave you wrong, Moses. That's one thing about God. He always leads you into truth, always leads you into righteousness. You know, people say, well, I don't know if I can hear from God. Let me tell you, how many books does he have to give us to tell you to lead right here?
Yeah.
Okay? God, I don't know if he talks. He talks to you every day. You spend time with him. He talks to you every day. What is this? You know, one thing person said the Bible stood for, I used to know a guy, he was a one of our greeters in the Walmart store at home, and he said, Tim, one day, he says, you know what Bible stands for? And I'm sure y'all heard it. The Bible stands for basic instruction before leaving earth. That's what Bible stands for. And I thought, man, that is really good. That basic instruction. We don't have an instruction, man, to get this life. Sure you do, right here.
Yeah.
It tells you. It don't matter if you're rich or poor. It tells you how to deal with people.
Mm-hmm.
That's what it does.
Yeah.
You know, you may not have any money, but you can sure treat people right. You can sure pray for them. You know, some of the people I met, they might not have had any money, but you know what they said? I pray for you. I believe God for you. Some of the people that didn't have that, it's not all about money. You know what it is? It's about faith in God. That's what's going to matter. You know, one person said, you know, you have Facebook. I don't know how much money. You know, you may have a big house, but the grave site's still the same size. You know, it doesn't matter. You may have this big link and you may have all this, but the grave site is still the same, right? And there's no way you can get buried in a vault. You can take all your money with you, but I'm guarantee you on the other side it ain't come with you. It's going to be still in the ground, and it's going to still be dirt in the ground. That's what's going to happen. But what's going to happen if you know Jesus Christ, you can spend an eternity with him. Isn't that going to be awesome? All the pain, like Paul said, ear haven't heard what God has in store. So we look toward the prize, right? Why are you in a race? Paul said that. Why, you know, you get in a race to win the race.
Yeah.
I'm just going to show up. No, we're not going to show up. You know, we're coming out here to win. We want to have victory. You know, we sing a song, Victory in Jesus. That's what it's about. It's having a victory in him. You know, I'm telling you what. You know, if we go and stay on the right path, and there's a highway to heaven, and that highway leads to Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. 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 It's all about Jesus. He has planned for life. All right. Anybody else? Anyone like to share tonight? Yes, Roberto.
Getting to Texas now. We should have been there by 10 in the morning, but the delays because of the rain.
Oh, yes, yes.
It was an eventful day for them. Anyway, I just, pray that now that they're over there with my brother, whatever the Holy Spirit did here, they carry over and spread, over there. My brother gets blessed.
Amen.
As well, as a result of that. I'm very excited about the things that God is doing, not only in my family, but in me individually. There's some good things that are happening, and I'm believing that they're coming from Him. So, He's taking care of us.
Amen. Amen. That is so awesome. We enjoyed having you, your mother and sister. It's great to share with saints from family. They're part of family. That's what they are. They're part of family. And God's got to have a big family, to be able to celebrate eternity and never have to leave. That was always a sad part. My mom, I was just thinking about her the other day. And whenever it was time for me to leave and come back home, and she always says, Tim, can we start over again? Like he was coming there. Can we start over again and start the vacation time over? I never lost that time. The thing about when you love somebody, you never get tired of spending time with them. You can sit there and spend all day with them, 2 or 3 weeks, and just love them and love them and love them. And think there'll be a day you'll never have to leave. Hallelujah. Someone else. Yes.
24 hours.
You got it. You got it, brother. God is a resurrection life. Yes,
brother. One more thing. Prayer request for my brother. He applied for a job, and he wanted to pray for the situation, and believing the gospel was going to happen. But not only that, I also want prayer for him to have revelation to know that he has the power within him to declare the things in his life.
Amen.
So,
amen. We will definitely do that. Hallelujah. Right.
Beginning of the end, there's no telling what God's got up his sleeve,
That's right.
He's just so marvelous, you can't even adequately start to describe it, but what an adventure we've got ahead of us, and so many times we go forward based on what we've been through, and going on around us, but he's so far beyond the circumstances and what we can see and feel, all of our feelings.
That's right.
It started just warming up, you know. I just praise God that we've got such a refreshing touch of God that prepares us for whatever lies ahead. And there's no failure in Him. So I just praise God that it's going to happen, and we're going to be doing it with God, and He's going to get the glory. Praise the Lord.
Amen. That's awesome, Don. That's awesome. Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Guy came and got me this week, Wednesday, to move me.
Mm-hmm.
And he's on the board of directors there. It is a spiritual house.
Hallelujah.
It's called Freedom House, and they have four houses, and I've known him for a long time. We've worked together, volunteer on a thing called Walk Your Ways. And when he picked me up, he drove me over there, and he said, I didn't know they'd do this. They really prayed a long time about where to send each guy.
Hallelujah.
And he said, this is the house where we all believe God wants you.
Amen.
So he said, we think you can be a good influence on these guys.
Hallelujah.
One of them's really down because he's really arthritic. Mm-hmm. Really great pain all the time. Can't work anymore. So this, you know, it just opened my mind. This is where God wants me.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
He took me down the stairs and showed me my room. I thought, wow.
Yeah.
It's a nice room. It has a nice recliner. That all the things I need right outside the door, bathroom, washing machine, dryer.
Hallelujah.
It's a great house. It's where I'm supposed to be.
Hallelujah.
And just one thing, I have a manner that takes me to lunch every Tuesday, and also through the Walk to Emmaus. There's a 40-year-old guy, and he has two sons, 10 and 8. And he told me this Tuesday that Jacob, the 10-year-old, still insists that we need to pray for being every day.
Oh,
he says his 10 and 8-year-old are praying for me every night.
Hallelujah.
It makes you feel good that they're the hit of the Lord at a young age.
That's right.
Brought up. So everything's good.
Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yeah. That's the kind of God we serve. You know, he's always more than enough. He's always running ahead. Think about all the blessings that you have. That's really what I'm looking at in my life, you know. You know, we sometimes we dwell on what we don't have instead of realizing what we do have. You don't have your health, your strength. You know, you got people praying for you and people that love you, that call you to check on you. You know, you have a job, you have a place to go. You know, there's people that don't. I see people, you know, different parts of the city, standing on the corner. I understand how it means to have nothing. I understand that, you know. But you always, you know, that's one value of the past, is never forget where you came from. Never forget what God done for you. Some people do. They get away from that life. And, Tim, I don't want to dwell. I'm not asking you to dwell there. We're not staying there. We just ask you to remember where you were at point A, and God got you to point B so he can take you to point C. Okay? He wants you to move forward. We're not dwelling back there. We're just saying, God, thank you. Thank you. I'm not where I should be. I'm not there. I'm not there yet, but I'm on the journey. I'm better than I used to be. You know, people say, oh, well, Tim, man, you don't, you know, you seem so calm and relaxed, you know? And I teach driving, let me tell you. You know, I teach semi-driving. You imagine driver's ed. Now I'm teaching a 40-ton vehicle. You know, well, you're so calm. You know, I said, well, I thank God that you see that in me. It wasn't always that way, let me tell you. It wasn't always that way, you know. You know, you drive. So I said, no. Just relax, because I know now, if I'm relaxed, you know what the student is? They're relaxed. You know, if I'm upset, they're going to be that way. So no, I've done the stuff they're doing now. But you know what? I give the glory to God when somebody says that, because I know. And that's what we always want to remember. Always remember where God brought you from. You know, the older saints, you say, he brought him from a mighty long way off. And that's the way it is. I remember walking that down the aisle, Reverend Butler. I was just thinking about him, and I want to share this about Reverend Butler. He was an older guy, older pastor, and he gave an altar call every Sunday. I don't see what it was, unless there was something unusual. He gave an altar call every Sunday. And I remember this, that this was apart from church. It was really hot. It had to be 9,800 degrees. And we was playing out in this, we had an area, had little trees back there. And it was really hot. And he didn't drive. He was probably 75. And we saw something coming through the trees. We didn't know what it was, you know. And Reverend Butler lived in town, middle of town. And we lived on the south side. But we saw something. And then we went. And he said, I think it's a man walking through their tent. And it was Reverend Butler. And I said, well, he said, where'd you come from? Somebody drop you off? He said, no, I walked, well, it had to be 8 or 9 miles, you know, clear on the south side of town. I said, what are you doing coming out here? He says, well, you know what? I just thought I'd walk out here to come and see you boys. Wow. You know what? That stuck with me to this day. Wow. You're going to walk in 98-degree heat, and you're 75 years old just to see us, just to tell us you care about it and God loves you. Don't you think that sticks with you? Yeah. That's what makes it. That told me he was a real man of God.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, that he would do that for us. And then you think about what Jesus done for you on the cross. Man, I could just see Reverend Butler. I love you. But you know what, Reverend Butler, I want to tell you something. This little boy grew up and he's teaching God's word because of stuff like that you did, that you made that sacrifice. And you let me know God was important. That's what you let me know. Hallelujah. Let's stand up and pray. And I gotta just thank God. Let's just take a few minutes. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, tonight, Lord, we want to thank you. Tonight, we want to praise you. We're going to call upon you. Because, Lord, we thank you, Lord. We thank you for you being the resurrection power as Mike goes down there. Because that's what it's about. Hallelujah. It's about your resurrection power. It's about your plans, Lord. It's about the job openings. It's about the doors that you open for us that no man can shut. We can look at those circumstances and realize it was God. It was you that did that for us. It was you. Hallelujah. And it's all about you. You got so many names. So wonderful. The true. The majestic God. There's only one. There's only one God. Hallelujah. And that's the Lord and Savior, our Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank you for the sacrifices that you made. We thank you for never giving up. Thank you for giving us a future and a hope. Oh, hallelujah. It's all about you, Lord. It's all about you that we're going to praise you. Thank you for moving in Dean's life. Get him to the place that you want him at. That you got those people praying for him. That's what it's about, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. As we go in our lives and realize that a lot of things swirl around. But, Lord, we know that you can calm the storm. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, that you can calm the raging sea with just your voice, Lord. Peace be still. Peace be still. Oh, those needs tonight that wasn't voiced. Lord, you know the cry of our hearts, Lord. That you would touch our hearts. Hallelujah. That we can call upon you. You call us with that everlasting love. Hallelujah. 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 And tonight, Lord, we're going to lift you up. That's what we're here today. To lift you up. To praise you. To believe you. That's what it's all about, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for dying for us on the cross, for giving us new life. Thank you, Lord, for all the saints that have prayed for us through the year, that are still praying for us, that are still believing that you would be with our pastor. Hallelujah, Sally. Lord, hallelujah. The pastor and missus, that you would just be with them and bless them and rejuvenate them. Oh, hallelujah. The ones that couldn't be here tonight, Lord, that you would be with them. Hallelujah. The ones that's working. Got family things going on. Lord, we want to thank you. We want to praise you for this congregation. We want to praise you for this church. Lord, that you would touch the people in this community. Let us continue to be the light. We need to be a light in our job, light in our homes, light wherever we may be. That people may look and say, what's the difference in you? What's the difference in you? Well, the difference is in me. It's Jesus Christ. That's what made the difference. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We praise you tonight. We lift you up tonight. We have to say it over and over again because you are wonderful, Lord. You are wonderful. You are wonderful. You are so wonderful. Hallelujah. We praise you. We thank you in your wonderful holy name. In your wonderful holy name we pray. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. Okay. And push it again.
Yep.
Okay. All right, let's declare the word.
Yeah.
Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you?
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him, the eyes of mine understanding being enlightened. And I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All right, Brother Juan, would you come up and be seated?
Yeah.
Pray for our offering, if you would, please.
John, you want to do the slides? I have felt the wind blow, whispering your name, and I have seen your tears fall when I watched the rain. How could I say there is no God when all at the bird and fly, soaring in the air, lying down beneath the stars. I feel your presence there, 'cause I understand that the ocean shore can feel the thundering breakers roar. To walk through golden field of grain, the blue horizon broken frame. 'Cause I'm listening to the river run, watering the earth, the fragrance of a rose in bloom, a newborn cry at birth. I love to stand where your wings fly. How could I say there is no God when all around creation calls, the singing bird, the mighty tree, the vast expanse of open sea? I love to stand at the ocean.
Show us your glory.
your glory. There's a cry.
There's a cry. The tears are hard. Ancient cry. This great prayer is a cry that Moses prayed. Hear today. Hear our glory. Show us your glory.
Show us your glory. Show us your glory, Lord. Show us your glory, Lord. Show us your glory. Show us your glory, Lord. As close as you want, consume this heart that longs to burn. I know your fire can hurt, but it will be worse here without you. For as close as you want. consume this heart that longs to burn. I know your fire can hurt, but it will be worse here without you. Lord, for I was made to dwell with you. And now I ache until I know. Holy God, take my heart. Verse 2. Come and take all these chains that get in the way of what you want. And as I stand in the flame, still I will say, I trust you, God. For
let us be in your presence so that our hearts become holy with you. Thank you, Lord. All we want is a humble heart. Guide us so that we can follow you wherever you want to take us. Thank you. Thank you. Praise the Lord.
Amen. Amen.
I'm very excited to be here tonight.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Mike, for leading us, being obedient. You know, there's a lot of good things that are happening. Excuse me. And I'm really excited. I told my sister the other day, well, I thought about this. I said, I want to look on the outside. I said, feel on the inside. And I told my sister, hey, can you pluck my eyebrows? Can you give me a facial and make me look good? So she did. And I don't know, it feels different. I told her to, I don't know, give me some tips on what to do, you know, to take care of my face and my skin and whatnot. It's all good. I'm very excited to be here tonight. I feel that this word that God gave me is going to be a revelation. It was very exciting for me when he was giving me this and the scriptures that he revealed to me and the meaning and the understanding that I got from those scriptures. I felt the Holy Spirit moving in that bedroom of mine when I was sitting there in my bed writing this, and man, I'm very excited. And I want to talk to you today about joy. But not just joy in general. I want to talk to you about the joy of the Lord. You know, some of the things that I'm going to start with might make me look like a Debbie Downer, but just stay with me because I'm gonna turn it all for good. You know, I said before that we're subjected to the things of this world, unfortunately, and one thing that comes as a result of that is that we have to deal with emotions. And there's so many emotions. You know, you have love, you have hate, you have fear, despair, sadness. There's so many that you cannot count them. But there's one in particular that I want to focus on today, and that is mourning. The dictionary defines the word mourn as a feel regret or sadness about the loss or disappearance of something. You know, it's when you're a little kid and you have a goldfish and your goldfish dies and you have to flush him down the toilet, you get sad, and then it goes on for a couple of days. You're mourning the loss of your little goldfish, or if it's your dog or you know, a pet or something. You lose a toy, anything. So, you know, when you think about this definition of the word mourn, you start thinking, what are some of those things that I mourn of as a human, you know? Well, if you lose your job, you're going to mourn because you're now not going to have that source of income. You also mourn when you lose a loved one, when a relationship ends. But you know, this is all normal because it's part of our human condition. But it's all part of the natural world. And sometimes it's hard for us to deal with some of those things if we don't have a strong foundation. And you know, we have to build the foundation of our lives on the Word of God, not based on our emotions. When we base the decisions that we make in our lives on our emotions, we're going to make bad decisions. Because you don't think clearly. You're not thinking rationally. You are letting something that you are feeling that is completely unrelated to your way of thinking to dictate what you're going to do, what you're going to say. So, you know, let's say you lost your job, right? Well, there's a million things that start going through your head. And all of a sudden, you can become mad if that happens. And some people, you know, if they're mad, they might think, well, the reason why I lost my job is because my boss had it in for me. And we start looking for someone to put the blame on. Well, you know, things of this world happen, and we have to deal with them. Because some things we don't have any control over. All we can do or say is speak the word of God to that situation to put it back in order. But, you know, going back to this example that I'm talking about, you can also become afraid. So you're going to start thinking, you know, now that I don't have a job, how am I going to pay my rent? How am I going to pay the electric bill? How am I going to put food on the table? You can also feel disappointment. Well, what's my wife or my husband going to think of me now that I don't have a job? They're going to think less of me, that I'm not adequate, that I cannot provide. And if you think about it, one thing happens, and there's a snowball effect of all of these emotions that are coming to you. And, you know, I'm not saying if that happens, you're weird, because we're just human, you know, we're going to have those emotions. It's completely normal within the human condition that we feel this way if something happens in our lives that we're not expecting. So I started thinking, how do we deal with this? And the Bible tells us how we're supposed to deal with that. And I want to start my first scripture, Mike, with Matthew chapter 5, verse 4, please. Okay, blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. You know, Jesus said this on the Sermon on the Mount. So, God himself in the flesh is speaking to us right there. If you mourn, you're blessed because you're going to be comforted. So the word comforted means to soothe, to ease in a time of affliction or distress. That's good news right there, you know. Jesus told us when we mourn, we are blessed because we will be comforted. When I think about this, I cannot help it but smile, you know. It makes me happy. You know, I feel joy that we have that word right there that we got from God himself when he was on this earth in human form. So if you could go to Psalms chapter 30, verse 5. So, you know, as I started thinking about joy, I started looking for scriptures that speak about joy. And I found this one. Psalms chapter 30, verse 5. For his anger endureth but a moment, in his favor is life. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. So as I'm reading this verse and I'm meditating on it, the Lord put in my heart the death of Jesus. So I said, why, Lord, are you putting this in my heart? Well, I started thinking of that whole event looking at it from the perspective of a day. So what happens at the end of a day? The sun goes down. Well, when Jesus died, the light of the world went down. So he was buried. He was in a dark cave. It wasn't shining. So that's the night. And then the morning came. And what happens in the morning? The sun comes up. The light shines again. He was resurrected. So when he was resurrected, the light of the world came up and it was shining again. So if Jesus is alive and he cannot die anymore, and he's the light of the world, are we going to have that light shining for eternity? I think we will. If you can go to Isaiah chapter 60, verse 20. And this is proof of that. Thy sun shall no more go down, neither shall thy moon withdraw itself. For the Lord shall be thine everlasting light, and the days of thy mourning shall be ended. That's good right there. The light, the sun shall no more go down. The light of the world is shining, and it will never disappear. So here's another prophecy for you. If you can go to Jeremiah chapter 31, verses 10 through 13. Hear the word of the Lord, O ye nations, and declare it in the isles afar off, and say, he that scattered Israel will gather him and keep him as a shepherd doth his flock. For the Lord hath redeemed Jacob and ransomed him from the hand of him that was stronger than he. Therefore they shall come and sing in the height of Zion and shall flow together to the goodness of the Lord for wheat and for wine and for oil and for the young of the flock and of the herd. And their soul shall be as a watered garden, and they shall not sorrow any more at all. Then shall the virgin rejoice in the dance, both young men and old together, for I will turn their mourning into joy, and I will comfort them and make them rejoice from their sorrow. He's going to turn our mourning into joy. We are going to rejoice from our sorrow. So whenever we are facing an affliction, a loss of something, let's remember that he's going to turn that mourning into joy and we're going to be comforted. When Jesus died, when he was buried and resurrected, the law was fulfilled. The prophets were fulfilled. And every single promise and prophecy in the Bible was cemented for eternity. And this is a guarantee that we, as fellow heirs of Abraham, we can have, because we can expect all the promises of God to be ours. If Jesus said that we're going to be comforted when we mourn, who am I to question him? I'll take that word any day. If you could go to Revelation chapter 21, verse 4. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. Everything's gone. Now that we're in him, there's no reason for us to be in despair, to cry, to feel sorrow, because we have him inside of us, and he makes everything good. The English Standard Version translation of the Bible has that verse as, "He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away." Neither shall there be mourning. When there is no mourning, there's joy. When we come to understand these things, when we have these things written in the tablet of our heart, and we believe them without a doubt, we're going to be filled with joy. If you can go to John chapter 15, and I need verses 1 through 11. "I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. And every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now ye are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Abide in me, and I in you. The branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine, no more can ye, except ye abide in me. I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit, for without me ye can do nothing. If a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch, and is withered. And men gather them, and cast them into the fire, and they are burned. If ye abide in me, and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you. Herein is my Father glorified, that ye bear much fruit, so shall ye be my disciples. As the Father hath loved me, so have I loved you. Continue ye in my love. If you keep my commandments, you shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things have I spoken unto you, that my joy might remain in you, and that your joy might be full." So what is he saying there? You know, the Bible says that God is love. When we understand, when we experience firsthand the love of God, and we abide in that love because we know how much he loves us and what he wants to do for us, and that we are his children, when we are abiding in that love, what's going to come as a result of that? You're going to be filled with joy because you know and understand what he is and how much he loves you, and that there is nothing for you to be ashamed of because now you are accepted. Now, I want to end with this. And these are some words that the Lord put in my heart on Sunday morning that I knew were for tonight. And this is what he put in my heart. "My heart mourns but for a minute. The joy of the Lord lasts forever." So that's my short message tonight. Hopefully it was full of the Holy Spirit. So let's just be joyful because he's good. You're dismissed in Jesus' name. I feel weird saying that.